Okay, so good afternoon once again to all these participants. And I will now proceed to my next task, and that is to introduce the first speaker for this afternoon. Okay, the first speaker, in the name of Engineer Jerry B. Maratas, is the owner and principal engineer of JMAR Engineering Services. He's also the president of Selgem Construction and Development Corporation, practicing structural engineers for 15 years with wide experience as structural designer and consultant to more than 2,000 projects ranging from hospitals, hotels, malls, commercial buildings, and high-rise condominiums. He is also the current president of PICE Cebu Chapter, a director of the Association of Structural Engineers of the Philippines. He is also a member of the Institution of Specialist Structural Engineers of the Philippines and a part-time faculty member of the Department of Civil Engineering of the University of San Carlos. Without further ado, I'll give you Engineer Jerry Maratas.
Thank you, Sir Rick Furness, for that kind introduction. So, good afternoon, fellow engineers. Mayong hapon ka na tong tanan. And I hope all of you are safe and healthy in the middle of this pandemic. Let's hope and pray that this crisis will end very soon. First of all, let me take this opportunity to thank all of you for participating in this first webinar. This is just the first of the four-part free webinar series that we are organizing. So the officers and the board of directors of the PICE Cebu are more than happy to offer you these free webinars as part of our commitment to serve our members even during this pandemic. So I'm looking forward to your participation in the succeeding webinars. The practice of structural engineering in the Philippines. So I hope this presentation will give you clear insights regarding the actual practice of the structural engineering profession here in our country. So this is the outline of my presentation. So first I'm going to give a quick introduction. Then after that, followed by an overview about structural engineering. Going to present the important elements in the practice of structural engineering here in the country. So I'm going to, under here, I'm going to discuss the qualifications of a structural engineer, also the market and demand of structural engineering services, then the different structural engineering services usually encountered in the practice of this profession. Also, I'm going to discuss the standard professional fees and also the prevalent professional fees here in Cebu. Then finally, I'm going to discuss the processes involved in performing the analysis and design of structures. So the picture in the screen taken last May during the implementation of the ECQ, or the Enhanced Community Quarantine. In the picture, you will see that the streets are almost empty. It's almost like a ghost town. You can't practically see people outside. What you will see are mostly buildings. Right? Now, let me ask you this question. How many of you are thinking the importance of these buildings during this period? Maybe only few, maybe no one. No? Why? Possibly because we are preoccupied thinking this pandemic and the possible impacts on us. Or maybe just maybe we don't worry about emphasize this, no? That most of these buildings were designed structurally and even built or constructed by civil engineers. Proud of our question. Our profession is indeed indispensable engineers association for so these are the project management and construction engineering. Then we have structural engineering, geotechnical engineering, water engineering, transportation engineering, and last one is environmental and energy engineering. Now, these are the structural engineering subjects under civil engineering. So, we all treat these subjects as major subjects during our undergrad years. So, if we compare this to other areas of specialization like geotech, construction management, transport, water engineering, they only have more or less 2 to 3 subjects. But structural engineering, we have 10. So in other words, structural engineering has been, I would say, given more emphasis under civil engineering. So no doubt, many civil engineers, after they graduate or pass the board, they really want to practice structural engineering. In fact, if you look at the enrollees in our master's program at the University of San Carlos, and by the way, Engineer Rick Fornes is the chairman of the Department of Civil Engineering, most of our masteral students there took structural engineering. Again, probably it's because the concentration of the subjects is geared towards structural engineering. So we can't blame if others equate civil engineering to structural engineering. But unfortunately, there are not many opportunities to practice structural engineering here in the Philippines. And if you look at the statistics, the civil engineers are actually in the field of construction. So what is structural engineering? So it is a discipline under civil engineering that deals with the structures that support or resist loads, ensuring the safety of the structures against natural forces. That's according to the NSCP, or the National Structural Code of the Philippines. No? That's the definition. Now, modern-day structural engineering provides a large, detailed body of knowledge that can more or less accurately predict the performance of different shapes and materials used in structures to resist loads and stresses. So that's the good thing about us today, no? So we have so many state-of-the-art software that are now available in the market. So like ETABS, STAAD, MIDAS, no? And they all can speed up, no, our design process. And not only that, it can also predict the possible performance of our structures when subjected to their design loads, no? So like in case there is an earthquake or typhoons, for example. Okay, so when we say structures, what does it mean? Now, I'd like you to look at the picture of the building on the left. No, that's actually our tallest project so far. That's the Double M Tower. And by the way, the last speaker in today's webinar will talk about the planned construction management of this building. The construction of this building, by the way, is currently ongoing. So this is a 57-story building, and once completed, this will be the tallest building, not just here in Cebu, but the entire Visayas and Mindanao. So the pictures on the right are the structural component of this building. Okay, in other words, it's the skeleton or the bones and muscles of the building. And that's the structure. So it's the main reason why buildings will stand. And we have, by the way, modeled this using ETABS and STAAD, because usually for our big projects, we use two programs or software for checking and verification. Now, structural engineering is a very old art and science. Huh? So the principles are being used for like thousands of years. And these are some of the structures in the early civilization. So you have the pyramids of Egypt, the Colosseum in Rome, Italy, which was built, constructed in 70 AD. Okay. Then we have the Westminster Abbey, our very own, no? Basilica Minore del Santo Niño, which was built in 1735. It's one of the oldest structures ever built here in the Philippines. Okay. Then these are the modern structures. We have the Burj Khalifa in Dubai. It's the currently the record holder for the tallest building in the world, no? With a height of almost 1 kilometer, more than 800 meters. Then we have the Sydney Opera House in Australia. Then you also have the Marina Bay Sands in Singapore. Now, take note, these structures or buildings have become landmarks and they became symbols of their country. Okay? So let's go to the objectives of structural engineering. Okay, so the main purpose of any structure is to support the loads coming on it by properly transferring them to the foundation. Okay, so this is actually the basic principle of structural engineering, that you design the structure to be able to carry all the design loads, including those environmental loads, no, like typhoons and earthquakes, and properly transfer them to the ground, no, simply because all structures are attached to the ground. Okay, so you have to design the structures to withstand the gravity loads as well as the environmental loads like typhoons and earthquakes or any loads that may foreseeably happen. Okay. There are only two basic requirements in structural engineering. That's safety and serviceability. Okay. So safety means that the structure, the strength of the structure must be adequate to support, carry all the loads that may foreseeably happen. And safety can be ensured by providing a capacity greater than the design loads. Okay? So in other words, when we say safe, the structure will not fail. Okay? So serviceability, on the other hand, refers to deflections, vibrations, and cracks that it should be within acceptable limits. So because there are some cases that are structures that are safe but not serviceable. So like for example, we consider long span beams. So you need to pay attention to the serviceability side. No? So not just the safety, but also you have to take a closer look on the deflections as well as the vibrations. Okay. So please remember this too. No? So safe and serviceable. That's the basic structural requirements. Of course, you have to consider also the economy of your structure. That should come on the third, no? Okay. Now let me differentiate these two terms: analysis and design, or structural analysis and design. So these two are distinct terms in structural engineering. So when we say structural analysis, it refers to the calculation of internal member forces such as the moment, no, or bending, the shear, and torsion. Okay, so it's also the calculation of the deflections as well as the deformations, and the verification that no unstable failure can occur. Well, structural design, so it refers to the proportioning of the sizes of the structural members to effectively resist the design loads. So it also refers to the determination of the required number of bars for a structure. So in other words, the two complement each other. So you cannot proceed with the design unless you are done with the analysis. Okay, you must have the internal forces. Okay, this is the expected outcome of your analysis. Okay, before you can perform the design. Okay. So this is the National Structural Code of the Philippines, or the NSCP. So this is more or less the Bible for structural engineers or those who practice structural engineering. So ASEP, by the way, it stands for the Association of Structural Engineers of the Philippines, to which I'm proud to say one of its current directors, no, is the architect of this code. And this is already the 7th edition, and this one was published in 2015. And we are currently working on an updated version of this. So hopefully we can release it in maybe next year or two. Now let me show you some structural failures. So the left picture is the Evas Hotel. This one is in Kilapawan City right after the earthquake in Cotabato last year. So the building is obviously experiencing partial collapse. Okay. Now, the right picture is the Ecoland condominium in Davao, and also collapsed last year after the series of earthquakes in the Davao regions. So this one is the budget builders in Cebu, in the aftermath of the 2013 Bohol earthquake. And on the right is the Sai building in Divisoria Mall. Okay. And it's worth noting, by the way, that this building, the Sai building, tilted without an earthquake. So by the looks of it, it's quite clear that this is a case of a foundation failure. So why I'm showing you these pictures, horrible pictures? I just want to emphasize that structural engineering is a very serious profession. There is a huge responsibility accompanying it. And we try to imagine how many occupants of these buildings. And without a doubt, no, they are all putting their lives, okay, and their very lives in the integrity of these structures. I remember one of my professors, instructors before, no, he said, if you are a structural engineer, you have the capacity of killing people in a wholesale basis. And it's really true. No? And that's, for me, the one of the beauty also of our profession. So it's very challenging. Now let's continue. No? So what is a structural engineer? Unsa man ang structural engineer? Kinsa man siya? O kanusa man ta mo ingon nga structural engineer na siya or ako, no? Now this is the definition coming from the code. No? So it is a structural engineer is a registered civil engineer, so or licensed civil engineer. So nakapasa sa board exam. Now with special qualification in the practice of structural engineering as recognized by the PRC or the Professionals Regulation Commission or by the specialty division of PICE together with ASEP and ESEP. Okay, you can see this definition under section 102 of the NSCP, the National Structural Code of the Philippines. So when you say special qualifications in structural engineering, it means you have the experience or expertise, no, in the practice of the profession, or maybe you have a master's or doctorate degree in this field. Okay, and take note, you must be recognized by PRC. Okay, or the specialty division of PICE together with ASEP and ESEP. Okay, now the PRC stopped giving recognition in the 1990s for some reasons. Okay, they gave it to PICE, which is the accredited professional organization or APO for civil engineering. For civil engineers. So in response, the PICE formed the 6 specialty divisions and it is tasked to screen and evaluate those who want to be recognized. Okay? And then sa PRC, kung naman ta, Board of Civil Engineering naman, there is no such thing as Board of Structural Engineering. Okay? So, ang mga specialty, they gave it to the PICA. Okay? Now, these are the requirements before you can be recognized as a structural engineer. Let's start with the PICA Specialty Division. Okay? So, magpa-accredit ka sa PICA Specialty Division. So, these are the requirements. Okay? So, all applicants, specifies life members, for example. So, no examination if the applicant has at least 15 years of experience. Okay? So, but if it's less than 15 years, so you have to take the exam. No? So, you have to have at least 10 years of experience before you can apply for a specialty membership in the specialty division of the PICE. Okay, so you have 5 years rated continuous active experience and you have accumulated at least 80 CPD units. No? And if you have a master's degree, okay, and at least 3 years in active experience, so you can qualify to apply, no? But still you have to take the exam. Okay, and there is also an interview or panel interview if you pass the examination. Okay, so in other words, so let's continue. No, so this one is for the ASEP. Okay, so if you want to become a member of ASEP. So a regular member, there are types of membership. No, you have the regular member, then you also have the ASEP. So regular member, no? Let's focus on the regular. You must be at least 30 years old at the time of your application, and you should have at least 7 years continuous and full time relevant structural engineering practice. So you must have at least 7 years of practice and you should be at least 30 years old. Okay, so if you are, you have a master's degree, that's equivalent to 2 years of active practice. And if you have a doctorate degree in structural engineering, that's equivalent to 3 years of active practice. So that means you still need to practice, let's say if you're a doctor, you need to practice for 4 years. Okay, so before you are qualified to become a member of ASEP. And you should have at least 60 CPD units and it should be endorsed by 3 active regular members. Okay? And you should pass the screening process by the membership screening board. Now for ASEP, which is the Institution of Structural Engineers of the Philippines, okay, these are the membership requirements. You should have at least 10 years rated experience with a certification of structural engineering specialty. So, ASEP, okay, only allows membership to those already members of the specialty division of the PICA. Okay, so you should apply first for the specialty division of PICA, okay, before you are qualified to apply for ASEP membership. Okay. So, you should also be an active regular member. So, medyo taas yung requirement, kinanglan recognized specialist ka by the PICE as well as you are a member of ASEP, a regular member of ASEP. Okay? So, in other words, you need to pass, I would say, a lot of these difficulties, no? Before being recognized as a structural engineer. Okay, but it is of course very achievable, no? And, but it will just take time. Okay, imagine it should be at least 30 years old, diba? It should have experience 10 to 15 years, okay, and so on and so forth, no? Now in my case, I was able to achieve all of this some sort of peer recognitions, no? 15 years since I became an engineer, so the age of 37, no? But mind you, the time is worth the wait. After all, this is something that I love. Okay? Now, let me read you a statement from a highly respected practitioner in the structural engineering profession. Okay? He said that in becoming a member of ASEP and also the ASEP, the civil engineering professional has taken the first step in being recognized and in claiming the right to be referred to as a structural engineer or as a structural specialist. And that is to obtain peer recognition, okay, as a practitioner of structural engineering. Now, without this peer recognition or any other accreditation from authorized government agencies, anybody can just claim that he or she is a structural engineer or a structural specialist. Okay? So it's very important also that you should be recognized by your peers in the industry. So question, can I design structures even if I'm not recognized as a structural engineer by the PRC or PICE, ASEP, and ESEP? The answer is yes, okay, as long as you are a licensed civil engineer. Of course, you can, no? So, but you cannot call yourself as a structural engineer, okay? Remember the definition from our code? So, you have every right to claim yourself as a structural engineer if you are a licensed civil engineer with special qualifications in the field of structural engineering, but you should be recognized, no? By the PICE, ASEP, or ESEP. Okay? So this is Article 1, Section 2 of the Republic Act number 544, also known as the Civil Engineering Law. It states that the practice of civil engineering shall embrace services in the field of consultation, design, no, and so on and so forth. No? Okay, so if you're a licensed civil engineer, that is enough already. No? That's your ticket to practice structural engineering. Okay. So what are the requirements to practice structural engineering? Okay, and so may akong mga kinanglanon kung mag-practice ko structural engineering. So of course, you need a PRC license, dry seal, PTR, professional tax receipt, and you should be knowledgeable in structural analysis and design. And it's advantage if you are proficient in the different structural engineering software. So you should be proficient also in CAD or computer-aided drafting software. Good communication skills. Then you should be updated also with the latest structural and construction engineering developments. Okay. So these are the. This one is the PRC ID. You need a PTR, okay? Kuha lang ka sa LGU, okay? Then you have to have also a dry seal or sealio, okay? Mora niya mo kinanglanon kung practice ka o structural engineering. Now let's go to the market and demand of structural engineering services. Okay, so there are three common design contracts, right? The first one is the prime design professional contract. In this type of contract, the owner or developer hire a prime or lead professional. So for buildings, big buildings, for example, they are usually the architects. Although occasionally for small projects, there are also civil engineers. So this lead professional will be the one to hire the services of the engineering consultants. Okay, so take note that in a building, there are many components. No? So we have architectural, structural, electrical, plumbing, mechanical, and so on and so forth. No? So the lead professional needs the services of his consultants, no, to complete the building plans. Okay, now for big projects, the owner most of the time hire a construction management team. No? So the function of this team will be discussed by our next speakers. Then after that, we have the contractor to implement the design. So in this setup, our client is the lead professional, which is usually the architect for the buildings. That's the first common contract. Okay. The second type of contract is the design and build. Okay, design and build contract. So in this setup, the owner or the developer hire directly a contractor. Okay, and by the way, most of the contractors are civil engineers. Now then this contractor, so he will be the one to hire the designers, no? So like the architect, structural, electrical, and so on and so forth. So this kind of setup is, I would say, built on trust. No? So imagine the contractor is the one in charge from the design to the implementation until the completion of the project. No? And usually the profit of the contractor is secured this setup. So in this type of contract, our client here are the contractors. So contractor na may hire na to, no? Ng structural engineer. Okay? Now, let's proceed to the third contract, no? This is the, which is the individual contract. No? So in this setup, the owner will hire the services of the designers, construction management, and contractor individually. Okay, so siya na, makuha siya ng architect, kuha na siya structural engineer, electrical engineer, no? Okay, all the consultants, even the contractor and the construction management. No? So this is actually getting popular nowadays, especially if the owner or developer has its own, especially if he has a strong, no, in-house construction management team. So in this setup, the developer has the full control, okay, of the project, no, from the design until the implementation and the completion of the project. So in this type of contract, obviously our client here are the developers, okay? So that's the good thing about the practice of this profession. No? So your market is more or less very defined, okay? And maybe 90% of your market, no, comes from this three, no? So remember, the architects, the contractors, and the developers. Okay, so that's a nice thing. Okay, now let's proceed to the demand of a structural engineering profession, okay, or services. No? So let me give you a glimpse, no, of the demand. So this is more or less the overview of our economy. No? So we have posted a considerable growth in the past 10 years. So, and I can really attest to that. No? So in fact, our office caters, no, to an average of more or less 30 projects a month, no? Before the pandemic. No? So unfortunately, I got mentored COVID, no? So I don't know yet what lies ahead after this. No? But hopefully we can all bounce this. No? Very optimistic that we can all overcome this pandemic. Okay. So this is the chart of the real estate loans from 2009 to 2018. And you see it's growing. No? So the right picture is the graph of the real estate index, no? So it's also growing until we got this pandemic, no? But the good news, some of these players are starting to adopt the new normal later on, no? So in fact, there's a news, I forgot to put it here, no? So just today, the real estate industry is slowly gaining its momentum. Now, according to Section 301 of the National Building Code of the Philippines, no, so the NBCP, no, so that's actually a law, no. So under Section 301, so this is about building permits, no. No person, firm, or corporation, including any agency, instrumentality of the government, shall erect, construct, alter, repair, move, convert, or demolish any building or structure without first obtaining a building permit. Okay, so in other words, construct ka rin ha, okay? Maski mag-renovate ka, you need to apply for a building permit. Okay, now these are the technical documents required in applying a building permit. Okay, so you need building plans. No? So under a building plans, naakay structural. Okay, remember a building is composed of several components. No? The structural is one component of a building. Okay, nakinsamay mo produce any structural plans, of course, the civil or structural engineer. Okay, and another requirement is a structural analysis and design competition, which is, of course, prepared by civil or structural engineers. So again, please take note, structural plans and structural analysis and design calculations are both required in the submission to OBO, no, or the Office of the Building Officials for Building Permit. Okay. And of course, the civil or structural engineers are the one preparing them. So I try to imagine how many building permit applications per day all over the country. I I'm sure that's a lot. And in Cebu City alone, they process an average of around 100 building permits per month. Now that's only for Cebu City. So that means it's about 25 per week, roughly 5 per day. But that data, of course, is pre-COVID. Okay, but I just want to emphasize that the demand is there. Okay. Now these are the common structural engineering services. No, so structural analysis and design of buildings. No, so bridges, billboards, transmission towers, and so on and so forth. You have the structural assessment, peer review, value engineering, preliminary studies, no, schematic design, construction phase design, construction estimates, preparation of rebar cutting list, and so on and so forth. Okay. Well, the first in the list is the, of course, the most common. So this is where you produce your structural plans and computations, no, for OBU permit application. Okay. So structural assessment is for existing structures where you are going to evaluate the structural integrity based on the existing condition of the structure. Okay. Now let me present the standard professional fees. Okay, so this is based on the manual for civil engineering practice, no? So sa PICE, no? Okay, by the way, there is a manual of practice for structural engineering which is still for review, no? So hopefully this will be released within the year or maybe early next year, no? So it is drafted by ESEP together with ASEP, no? Okay, so in this professional fees, there are basically two criteria, no? So first is based on the structural construction cost, while the second is based on the floor area, no? Okay, the minimum fee is 40,000 pesos for small projects. Okay, so kung mag-practice like a structural engineer, considering all these standard professional fees, most likely mayahiga, no? Okay. If based on the floor area, the minimum is 125 pesos per square meter. But again, that's just for big projects, no? Okay. So let's say we charge only, let's say, minimum of 125 per square meter. And let's say you have a project of 10,000 square meters. Okay, medyo dako-dako na building. So that means that's 1.25 million, no? Okay, for your professional fee. So pwede na duhay mo sawa na, no? Just kidding, no? Now, but those are standard fees, okay? So how I wish, no, all practitioners follow those rates, no? But the reality is, even with all these demands, no, so we are not well compensated. Many practicing engineers charge way, way less than what we deserve, okay? Very unfortunately, no? Our clients are also paying us way, way low, no? And yet expecting us to produce more and more. I hope one day this will be corrected. But for now, it remains a dream. No? Okay. Now, these are the current rates right now in Cebu. Okay. So these are obviously way, way less than the standard fees. But mind you, there are other engineers, no? Charging smaller than this, no? And for me, it's adding insult to injury. So there is a Cebu, 30 nga to sa 60, no, per square meter. And you have a drafting fee of 800 to 1,500. So very, very small project, minimum charge 10,000 to 15,000 pesos. Then for rapid structural assessment, it's also a common structural service, no? So it's 15,000. Then if it's detailed assessment, so minimum is 100,000 pesos. Okay. Right, so it's almost time, no? So now let me proceed to the structural analysis and design process. Okay, so structural, by the way, I'd like to take note, structural analysis and design is often an iterative trial and error process, and this involves the judgment of the design engineer. Okay, and I divided, by the way, this into five stages, no? So we have the pre-design and planning stage, modeling and analysis stage, structural design stage, drafting and scheduling stage, review and evaluation stage. The first stage or the pre-design stage involves the following, no? So configure the structural system, okay, configuring the building frame based from the architectural plans, then you assign the initial member sizes, then you assign design data, no? So you have to establish the design criteria, no? Like design loads, material properties, soil properties, and so on and so forth. I will no longer go into the full details of this one, okay, because obviously time constraints, okay. Now the second stage is the modeling, no? And analysis stage, no? So under here we have to model the structure using a structural software, no? Okay, so you need structural software para mas dali yun, no? Okay, magmano-mano pa ta, it will really take time, okay, and besides kuansad ka ng daghan kayong assumptions, no? So dili na siya, medyo accurate na siya, no? Okay, so really have no choice but to adapt to this technological advances, no? So you have to dance with the music, okay? So under the modeling analysis stage, you have to perform structural analysis, perform cross checking, review the stability and displacements of the structure, and you make the necessary adjustments, no? Okay. So adjusting the sizes, adding or removing some members, etc., etc. Then you have to perform another cycle of analysis until all are satisfactory. Okay. Now the middle stage, the third stage, the structural design stage, no? So in this stage, we have to proportion the member sizes. So remember, before we can design the structural members or elements, we need the result of the analysis, no? So we need the internal stresses, no? On the members. So that's the third stage, no? The structural design stage. So we have to compute the reinforcements, no? For RC structures based on the initial members, no? Okay, and the computed stresses. Then to design cross slabs, beams, columns, footings, walls, trusses, and other structural members. Okay. The fourth stage is the drafting and scheduling. So once you're done with your model and the design, so you have to reflect. Okay, you have to transfer this to the plans, no? Because your plans, okay, will serve as the medium or the bridge between you as the structural designer to and the contractor, no? Or the implementer of this project. Okay, so can you take note of these items that must be reflected in the structural plans, no? So you have the general notes, typical construction details, foundation plans, framing plans, no? Then the schedule of the structural members, the footings, columns, beams, slabs. Then you have to include also structural details, no? So like stairs, shear walls, trusses, no? Where applicable. Okay. Then finally, the last stage is the review and evaluation stage, no? So you have to review the plans and all the design outputs. Okay. And it's very natural and very often, no? And you really have to perform revisions and adjustments in the design. So there is no such thing as a perfect design. Okay. So these are the outputs of your structural analysis and design, no? So on the left, that's the example of structural plans, okay? And second, the structural analysis and design computations, no? Then you submit this to your client for permit applications, not just for permit applications, but also for bidding purposes and also for construction purposes, okay? So after that, maningil din ka, no? Okay, sa final billing. Okay, that's that ends my presentation. I hope you have gained some insights about the practice, no, of the structural engineering profession here in the country. So thank you. Daghan kayong salamat, no? Keep well and safe.